bring in Dr. Levy. Let's get him right in here. Mickey Levy, Bank of America. He's going to saunter in here. It's a break exclusive. Let's get right to it. Dr. Levy disagreeing with Professor Romer a little bit on food. Here's the chart. UN food. Mickey, you'll see it down here. You don't have to. Victor's wide. Victor's wider than he was because he's been eating chocolate all morning. Food is exogenous. You can see it down here. Outside the system, you respectfully disagree with a professor from Berkeley.
Well, if we consider food prices, materials prices, commodity prices, they're part of it is due to supply constraints. Part of the rise in prices is due to global demand. But, Tom, you have the U.S. Fed plus other major central banks keeping rates extremely low and pumping liquidity into the system. So part of the increase in all these commodity prices is driven by old-fashioned central bank policy pumping in too much money. It's not exogenous. So here's the critical issue. If you treat it as exogenous and ignore it because you're just looking at core inflation,
right,
you might miss rising inflationary expectations and bond yields. Or you might miss the period like 2004, 5, 6, when you had soaring oil prices when the Fed was trying to catch up after being too easy. So don't think of it as entirely exogenous. If we didn't have all this
right
liquidity in the system, it'd be a different story.
A lot of my viewers who have a PhD in common sense would say it's the old free lunch idea. And that we're looking for a free lunch here. We're doing QE2. Granted, Bill Dudley's saying here today it's worked. It's no question about it. Spurred the economy. The rhetoric of the president on stimulus has spurred the economy. Am I right to say there's got to be a price to pay out there somewhere if you have that big free lunch?
Well, firstly, monetary policy works with a lag. The Fed's been accommodative for quite a while. I'm not so sure QE2 has contributed that much currently, even though it's happened simultaneously. But do you eventually pay for it? Yes. The free lunch the Fed's been provided so far is we've had these unsustainably high budget deficits, and the Fed's mm-hmm. monetized it, call it whatever you will. And the free pass has been it hasn't driven up inflationary expectations. Eventually,
well,
it has to.
Here's William McChesney Martin. Thanks to Christina Romer for quoting this in one of her recent papers. This is one of my heroes, folks. William McChesney Martin, former Fed chair, 1951, codified the Fed's independence, a mistaken revolution. If inflation should begin to develop again, it might be that the number of unemployed would be temporarily reduced. Is that what this is really about? Is to hell with inflation. We got to get people employed, and we'll worry about inflation later.
Well, we do have a major problem with unemployment. My concern is a significant portion of the increase in the unemployment rate has not been cyclical, that you can just pump money in the system, create aggregate demand that's going to generate jobs. It's either structural or, as Fed Chairman Bernanke says, it might take 5 years, and that's a long time. And so I think we need to address the specific areas where there are economic weakness and address the specific areas in the labor markets, like semi-skilled jobs, rather than have the Federal Reserve pump in money and hope they can continue to increase or try to increase aggregate demand without triggering higher inflationary expectations.
Services consumption. This is from Mickey Levy's note with the Bank of America. Bring it up here. I just use this chart. It's a different glide path. There's a real persistency up to the crisis, and then services consumption goes flat. There's a lot of OER in there and real estate and all that. Well, we're sort of on a new glide path, but Dr. Levy, that's not the same glide path we all enjoyed pre-crisis, is it?
Well, that's right. If you look at consumption of services, it has been a significant underperformer. What's striking is during this recovery, consumption of durable and non-durable goods have been about average compared to prior recoveries, but consumption of services has lagged. Well, great question. It may be that households are changing their consumer spending behavior as they try to save a little more. Rather than delaying buying a durable good, they're cutting back on a lot of services. But I think a critical point here is the following, and particularly today when President Obama distributes the his budget for fiscal 2012, and that is, there is a very nice cyclical recovery that's getting traction and gaining momentum. And everybody's on board with that, and I think we're going to create a lot more jobs. But the critical issue is, what do you do about the long run? What are the long run impacts of tremendous increase in government indebtedness without it adding much to productive capacity, given the composition of it, with at the same time the Fed monetizing that deficit? These are long run problems that go way beyond the cyclical rebound.
I'm traveling to Richmond after the show today to meet with one Jay Lacker down at the Richmond Fed tomorrow. And, you know, he's asked me to come down there, and we're going to really jawbone it through the entire first half hour of the program. And when you talk to Jeffrey Lacker, there seems to be a lack of confidence that we can unwind all this accommodation. I know you agree with that. What have you observed in the last 90 days or so that really gives you pause, where Bill Dudley says, no, we can unwind from QE2?
Well, there are a couple issues. Unwinding QE2, I think the Fed is going to have to signal it to the market and expect that, you know, rates have already increased a little bit, but they have to signal it way ahead of time to the markets what they're going to do in QE2. If inflationary expectations start rising a lot, they may not just passively allow their balance sheet to run off. They may need to do more proactively. Now, that's the Fed, and we've already normalized rates. Then there's the issue of fiscal policy. Mm-hmm. How do you exit an unsustainable policy when, at least to date, the politicians aren't really on board with doing what needs to be done?
And you don't see that with a budget released today?
No.
I mean, the answer was. Trick question, Jim. Throw a Valentine at me. I got that. Man, yeah. What a shock. You weren't happy with the budget.
It's a step in the right direction. I think politicians on both sides of the aisle have expressed their disappointment in the budget. And, you know, what I would like to see is, you know, President Obama, his commission came out with a nice study with a lot of nice recommendations that should have been the basis for debate. But now the budget, what does it include that we see today? Mm-hmm. Ignoring basically what the commission said.
Ignoring the commission, ignoring long run challenges.
And we definitely need to address that. So the bottom line is, right now we have unsustainable monetary policy and unsustainable fiscal policy.
Mickey Levy, thank you so much.